Hey, Darren, how are you doing?
Good, thanks, Herbert. Nice to chat with you today.
Well, it's good to see you as well. You've had a busy season already. I guess you've been quite busy.
Yeah, look, our season starts in about November last year when we have our little break, and then we start back again. We start planning, and athletes begin training for the season ahead. We're based in the Southern Hemisphere, which includes some little minor races around the summer of the Australian summer. But by the time I get to about May, I've pretty much gone straight through for about 5 months. So right now I'm back in Australia just for a couple of weeks. The athletes are all over the world by and large, and we're looking to meet up again in about a week and a half in the preparation phase for the race in Madrid.
Yeah, so I guess most everybody who cares about the World Triathlon Series is now congregating in Europe.
Yes, that's right. So all of my athletes who race the World Series, bar just one, is currently in Europe, and just most of them will be at home preparing and looking forward to racing in a week and a bit.
So do they all have different agendas or schedules as there's only like certain select races they could actually do to kind of stay in tuned and in shape?
Yeah, so everyone goes back to their home environment, and part of my job is to make sure that we communicate well when they're so far away. So I end up doing quite a lot of work, in my phase where I'm home, supposedly having a bit of a break. It ends up being quite busy because, for instance, this morning I'd be talking with somebody in the States, or an athlete here in Australia, and then in the afternoon we'll have somebody wake up in South Africa. I'll be chatting to them, and then maybe the Europeans start waking up first of all, the people in Italy, then finally the ones in the UK and so forth. So yeah, it's about communicating well, and I have a very interesting life because most people go to work, whereas I might be speaking to six or seven people from all around the world within my daily existence.
And then, so how do you check their pro how do you actually check their progress when you're not hands on? When you kind of, you just get feedback from them what they've done or what's working or what's not working, how does it go?
Yeah, so yes, we get feedback. Some athletes will be on the sending me messages every single day. Others will need a bit of a chase up at times. But by and large, they're all very motivated, and we have great working relationships. So, as you probably know, if you've got a good relationship, then it's pretty easy. It's easy work. We have this phase. We often send people back for a little bit of testing within their national federation. So, some monitoring of some training sets. We might even do some sessions that were done last year before the Olympics, just to see how they're going, give them a little bit of confidence that we're heading in the right direction. Also, a chance for the federations to finally see their athletes. The athletes have just been away overseas. The federations haven't seen a lot of them. It's a good chance for them to, attend meetings, brief the performance directors about how they're going and what we need in the future and so forth.
Is the communication line to those national federations pretty good, or does it depend on the country?
By and large, very good. There is a turnover of national coaches every year or so. For some federations, they go through lots of personnel, and I have to keep abreast of who's in and who's not. And when I went to the Olympics last year, we had some all the national federations became much more involved in the preceding period, and it was my job to know which national coach had the skills to deliver at an Olympics, which national coach had been to three already and had a track record of being very calm under pressure and so forth. And then there were others who were going to their first Olympics and probably needed a bit more guidance from me. So I made sure that I formed really strong relationships with these federations. And of course, there's a couple of hiccups every so often. Sometimes we have a new national coach come in, and you know, he's been appointed, and he's you know, he's trying to wield a little bit of a stick, trying to make his mark. But it doesn't take too long for him to realize that, you know, basically the athlete and myself are the ones that do the work. He should in part be helping facilitate how we get better and not try to put up barriers in our way.
So, I mean, ego is surely coming into play here, right?
There are definitely some egos, but look, I think my strike rate and my track record is pretty strong. So most of them, you know, rightly give me a fair bit of respect. And until further notice, until we screw up, then they give me quite a bit of freedom within the boundaries of, you know, what their funding allows, what hurdles they might have in terms of making sure their athletes are moving in the right direction.
Talking about athletes, you just had Emma Moffat join you. Is that correct?
Yeah, Emma's going to join us officially from a week and a half when she comes over to Europe. And we've just done a little bit of base work, me getting to know the system that she's had, some of her, you know, the little bits that relate to Emma that I need to, you know, need to know so that I can make sure she moves forward pretty smoothly after she joins us. So, I'd rather not spend 6 months or 12 months getting to know her. I don't want to make up things that have already been done very well. I want to find out from her previous coaches who I've spoken with about the things that really work quite well and the things that maybe they'd would have liked to have tried in the future if they had the chance. You know, insights into how we can do a better job.
And just from, I guess, have you seen her at all or have you just spoken to her?
Yeah, we caught up a little bit before the last couple of World Cups, the World Series races, and, you know, just we invited her in to join us for, say, a ride of the course and going through some of the corners and the, you know, little bits like that. But we certainly haven't had a great deal to do with her yet.
So talking about the next couple of races, Madrid and then Kitzbühel. I guess Kitzbühel is next, and then Hamburg.
Yep. Hamburg after, yeah.
Are there any specific races you look forward to in terms of just what's on offer, or is it all the same? It's a race that's worth points and your athletes need to perform.
Yeah, so we don't have to do every race in the World Series to do extremely well in the overall standings. You know, there's a certain number that you have to count, and so there's not an obligation to do every single race. Now, if somebody's in a post-Olympic year, every athlete has slightly different goals. Some people will really want to be excelling overall in the whole series. So that means a high finish, maybe even a medal might be on their target or top five overall. And that's a different scenario with an athlete who's been around for a while, who really would love to just get on a podium somewhere or win a race. So winning a race at the World Series is a different thing to being on the podium at the end, because the podium at the end is really a reward for consistency. So I've got different people eyeing off different goals. We have the Commonwealth Games coming next year, and most of the Commonwealth countries will have London, the final series race, as the big one. A number of them already have selection criteria based on performing well in that particular race. So that might be the most important race for some of my athletes of the year. So, of course, in terms of the skill sets of the athletes, there might be some real mountain goats, you know, people who can ride a bike up a hill like a mad person. And so they're going to be really motivated to look for a race, you know, the new race of Kitzbühel and their new design of the course, climbing for about 12 Ks right up to the top of the mountain and then running even higher after that. So that's going to suit somebody who really you know, loves climbing, is really good at it and so forth. Whereas there might be others in the squad who are really just not built that way. They might be great in flat water, flat roads, fast technical courses and so forth. So not all of my athletes will actually do Pittsburgh.
Yeah, I mean, my thinking was, like, I understood why quite a few folks didn't go to Yokohama, just because it was kind of an outlier race in terms of just where people traveled. But with so many races so central in Europe, I figured it would be so easy, and you would just take one just because it's there, even if the end result doesn't matter. You just use it as a training race to kind of stick.
Yeah, you know, Herbert, if sometimes a bad experience isn't a great experience. So you want to be a little bit careful. When you're racing the best in the world, you know, I try not to put athletes into bad positions. So if I know that somebody is in a heavy training block, they're not ideally suited to a mountainous bike leg, then it's unlikely that I'll put them into that position, because, frankly, you'll never end up with a very good outcome.
Right. That makes
sense. So we have to treat these races with real respect. It's easier if we have something that's just down the road and it's a little short race and it's a sprint and, you know, there's no pressure. But if you're on the world stage and rankings and federations and so forth are all watching, then you have to be a little bit careful about, you know, making sure that you get it right in that regard.
Talking about getting it right, you have something big happening for you. You're actually moving stateside shortly.
Yes, absolutely. At the end of the season, I'll be moving. My wife has got a job with the USOC, and we'll be heading up their nutrition program for the Paralympics athletes.
And didn't I hear from you that you just built a house?
Yeah, life's doesn't always flow in easy directions. So yes, my wife and I have just built a house here in Australia. We pick up the keys, in fact, tomorrow. Within, you know, 2 weeks ago, she also mentioned that she'd been approached and is interested in taking this job in the States. So, you know, it doesn't always work out in a perfect fashion, but we'll work through those issues and see what happens with the house here.
So what does it mean in terms of you getting organized? Can you even travel anywhere, or you just have to organize your household to get it ready for a big move?
Yeah, we do. You know, if you're in a house and it's quite a good size, then you tend to expand what junk you have in your life. And then when you have to move or you have to put things into storage, then you start clarifying things a little bit more and maybe decluttering things. And so, yes, we're spending a bit of time these days decluttering, getting rid of some of the stuff that we really don't need to take overseas and perhaps don't even need to put into storage. I guess if you don't touch a book for 4 or 5 years, then it's really just a bit of stuff sitting on the shelf there that maybe somebody else could get some value out of. So, you know, it's a time where I've pretty much got a rule that says that if I haven't touched something for a year or so, then I think that's one that I can probably pass on.
Well, on clothing, that's certainly I think that's certainly true. And on books, they maybe have a little bit longer shelf life than a year or two. But I hear you for sure.
Yeah, that's right.
So, listen, we let you run. Wish you all the best in Madrid. And then also for those athletes who are going to Kitzbühel, the same. And then, of course, Hamburg and then Stockholm and then London. And we'll probably talk to you sometime again soon.
Yeah, thanks for your time, Herbert. It's been nice chatting with you.
Well, we'll catch you later.
Okay.
Bye.
Yeah.